Hello.
One page.
Welcome to the College of Complexes, everybody. My name's Don. I'm the moderator this evening. Tonight's presentation, issues the candidates don't discuss or debate. Annual censored news update from Andy Anderson of the Northwest Information Service. He's right out here at the College of Complexes. Andy has spoken many times at the college before on the topic of 9/11, this being only 6 days after the fateful the anniversary of the fateful day. Now, my name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening.
Thank you.
I'm also the treasurer here at the College of Complexes. We charge a tuition of $3. If you haven't paid already, just come see me. Now, let me just explain the format of how the college works very briefly. First of all, we will have announcements on upcoming events in the community. I would just like to say that that's a time for announcements, not for big long speeches. And now, second, our speaker Andy Anderson will talk. His lecture will be for approximately an hour. After Andy's lecture is over, we will have a question and answer session. That's a time for questions, not for speeches. After our Q&A session, we will have our infamous rebuttal period, for which the College of Complexes is justly famous. And during that time, anybody here in the restaurant can come right up here to the podium and have 5 minutes to make as big a fool out of themselves as they want.
Like you're doing now.
Well, that brings me to one of our rules. Yeah. One of our rules is one fool at a time.
Yeah.
All right? So so those who interrupt the speaker, as Charlie just did, should be reminded of the rule. Repeat after me, everybody. One fool at a time. After the rebuttal period, our speaker will have the final word. He will get to rebut all the rebuttals. All right, then without further ado, let's have give it up for our speaker tonight, Andy Anderson.
Yay! All right, Andy.
We'll have roughly four segments, 14 minutes apiece, talking about the 14 four categories that are listed on that media censorship flyer. Hey, Tim, can anybody do something about the shade back there with the sun shining right in our eyes here?
Can I try to adjust it?
I gotta move the podium over a little bit.
Wow,
who would have thought? Okay. For those of you that have never been to one of my talks, my brother and I run what we call the Northwest Information Service out of Palatine.
Oh, right.
It's a free service. We collect and translate books on blacked out subjects, things the reporters can get fired for writing about. In America, there's a coordinated media effort to keep Americans in a bubble of mythology and ignorance on certain subjects. So it's a two-pronged process. They promote the myth on all channels 24/7 while they simultaneously run a coordinated blackout on what I call Albert and his friends. Picture Albert Einstein and 500 of his friends in the physics department saying, "The Earth isn't flat. We got good pictures from the space shuttle." Well, what are you going to do on any subject with a group with Nobel Prize winners in there and scientists with 30 years of credibility, like Albert and his friends, giving you the forensic evidence, the real-world evidence of what it is, if it goes contrary to what the politicians are telling us? You have to run a coordinated blackout. It's a two-pronged process. You just can't promote the myth on all channels because people will find out that there's groups of researchers, scientists that are publishing the reality. So you have to run a coordinated blackout, and also you have to have talking heads in the media routinely denigrate these people as conspiracy theorists, kooks. For those of you that missed it, I would suggest you go to the website of College of Complexes or Tim's video. When last week's program was the best one-hour presentation we've ever seen here of how you present facts as somebody's crazy opinion. And then somebody's crazy opinion is presented as fact when it has no basis in reality. Our speaker put out numerous false statements last week, and the question I have is, was he intentionally lying to us and he knew he was lying? Or is he actually part of a cult that believes that stuff that's so far out of touch with reality that it constitutes a mental health issue? When somebody is standing in a blizzard of evidence claiming they can't see a single snowflake, then you begin to ask, are they part of some sort of cult that believes this or promotes this idea? In America, we have something called the cult of Amway. The idea that you can become an independent, wealthy distributor is promoted as a viable business model when the reality is that it sucks a massive amount of time and effort and labor and resources from people at the bottom supporting people at the top of the pyramid. But that's Walmart is another one that takes tremendous resources out of every community that they plunk a store down. The community has to support the workers with various kinds of welfare and unemployment, and child care. Walmart workers qualify for all kinds of community aid, where a normal business that pays living wage, that doesn't happen. But those are just a couple of the things that are not talked about in America because the media has control. My brother and I generally digest a book a week. So at the end of the year, we have 50 books, taking time off for Christmas and the holidays. We add 50 books to the library that we have. We've been doing this for almost 4 years now, so we have our own personal library of about 4,000 books that deal with blacked out subjects. Listed at the top of this flyer that I gave you, these two books, if you don't have time to read 50 or 100 books on the environment, get a copy of Naomi Klein's This Changes Everything. This came out in 2015. She's an investigative reporter that's been writing about environmental issues for a long time. Her book, No Logo, that came out in 2004, was a game changer talking about capitalism. But this book talks about, the subtitle is This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate. She describes how free enterprise capitalism is at war with the environment and the planet now. We're in World War III. It's not being faced fought with bombs and missiles so much as it is with capitalism destroying large swaths of the environment everywhere to make 90-day corporate profits. This other book, these two are among my top 10, incidentally. People ask me, what are your top 10 books of all time with all the ones you've seen? Well, these two are in the top 10. The other one is called Unprecedented. It's Unprecedented, Can Civilization Survive the CO2 Crisis? And that is on the back side of that flyer, media censorship. It's listed right there in the under the number one heading, climate crisis. These two books there's tons of references in both of these. They're like summaries of the work done by Albert and 500 of his friends on these subjects. On many subjects, you have groups of scientists with long credentials. There's, for every media climate denier, there's 300 or 400 scientists in the climate community around the world that are saying global warming is real, it's happening now, it's not debatable. I have some printed flyers that we can give out later at the end if anybody wants information on that beyond the talk tonight. So, my brother and I, our whole thesis, that is our organization, revolves around Project Censored out of Sonoma State University. This year is the 40th anniversary of Project Censored, a program that produces this book every year. It's got the top what they consider the top 25 most explosive, blacked-out stories that would change America overnight in a heartbeat if they were covered rather than intentionally blacked out. If our speaker last week had cracked any one of these books between 2006 and 2011, he would have seen all the articles published by the investigative reporters out of Sonoma State showing that 9/11 was orchestrated by the Bush administration. We weren't attacked by Muslims on 9/11. The database on that is as solid as the database on asbestos and cigarettes. Huge database on one side of the, you know, once in our database becomes ingrained and known, then there's no longer any credible debate. 30 years ago, some of you may remember if you're old enough, 30 years ago you could have gotten into a fist fight at a restaurant if you asked somebody to put out their cigarette. Now, I mean, people said, I have a God-given right to light up and puff away anywhere. We still have smokers, but they respect the rights of others, they respect the law. Some people are still addicted to tobacco, and they're trying to, you know, hopefully they plan on giving it up. My brother was addicted for 30 years. And he finally quit smoking 3 years ago, and his health improved. So your health generally improves when you stop smoking. There's on the subject, there's a website called Truth Out. It's probably listed in the websites down there. Common Dreams and Truth Out are two of the best news sites that post the best of the best news. It's on the back side listed with the references there, so you can follow along in the talk tonight. If any of you would like an official different reference or something, or you have a question briefly, just raise your hand and we'll enter the reference into the record while Tim is taping this, rather than waiting until the very end during the rebuttal period. So we can have a better exchange of information. If you have a question about something that I'm talking about, I can clarify it real quick or give a reference in real time. Because the subjects, these four subjects that are listed in the main censorship paper, there's an enormous database of documented books, articles, thousands of scientists working on these things all over the world. Is there anybody here that doesn't understand what I'm talking about between a database supported by thousands of scientists and an opinion broadcast by somebody like Rush Limbaugh?
Yes.
Or is everybody familiar with that? Because yes, we get inundated with opinions that have no basis in reality. They're actually false. Last week, we talked about that, number four, we had a media circus last weekend. They reinforced the myth on all channels, newspapers, radio, television. We were bathed in mythology from Friday to Sunday night. And it's because we're up to 50% of the public now in America. Half of the public understands that 9/11 was an inside job, but they don't talk about it because they don't want to be attacked by how you can get attacked verbally by a couple people that are in this room periodically and say, oh, you're full of it, it's a crock of shit, that can't be real, that's just your wild opinion. Well, that's what my talk tonight is about, helping you understand where the documented databases of facts are. You have a question, Charlie?
What, there's no such thing as a database. I mean, there's information that's stored in libraries and what have you, but there's a database that says Columbus discovered America. I mean,
what's your point, Charlie?
A database does not establish the truth because there can be a counter one, and no one's policing the information going into just printed matter.
Let me see if I can try this again, Charlie. At some point in the past, ancient people believed that if you sail off the edge of the earth, you just fall off into space. Today we know that's no longer true because there's an enormous database of published evidence of people going around the world in ships, planes, hiking, satellite pictures. We know the earth is relatively round. You could debate that 2,000 years ago. Today that's non-debatable. The database of all forensic evidence on the round earth issue is huge. It's 99.9% certain compared to the 0.1% of people from the Flat Earth Society in England. At latest count, there's a, I heard there's about 1,800 people in the Flat Earth Society that put out briefing papers and things promoting the view that Charlie just said. Well, there's a counter opinion. How can you know what's real? Well, you look at forensic evidence published by people that have scientific credentials and use your own critical thinking. There's a huge database of published evidence on the health hazards that accrue to a third, at least a third of the population from cigarette smoking. There's an enormous database that's published, it's non-debatable, lawsuits coming up through the courts being settled on breathing asbestos dust in factories. They shut the factories down because the evidence became so solid that it forms a base of non-debatable, non-challengeable evidence that is 99.9% certain. You cannot wait, you cannot keep creating doubt by paying a scientist to create doubt like the tobacco industry did and the fossil fuel industry did. This is how people give the impression that there's two sides to the debate. And I think that's what Charlie's talking about. As long as there's one guy out there saying there's no global warming, let's just not do anything about it. Let's reserve judgment. And we have big problems. The climate change is already recording islands out in the Pacific, low-lying countries that are slowly disappearing as the sea levels rise. There's no debate on this anymore. There's no real debate. The debate is when we allow the media and the fossil fuel industry and the billionaires to hire somebody to come up to be half of a debate. You hire a climate denier to deny the fact there's any global warming. And then you have one scientist from the 987 that are in one group, or whatever it is. There's hundreds of climate scientists all over the world with credentials. And the doubters, the debate, the deniers are absolutely right about the subject of climate denial. They're saying they're constantly changing the numbers. They're changing the computer numbers all the time. You know, the numbers aren't solid. Well, what they're showing is they're updating the numbers quarterly, half yearly. The numbers about how fast the methane is melting in Russia now, permafrost. The methane is beginning to bubble up from frozen tundra into the atmosphere. So all scientists, climate scientists now generally recognize that the methane problem can be 20 times worse than the fossil fuel burning of CO2 going into the atmosphere. We're looking at apocalyptic projections if we don't do something. And the science is getting more and more and more solid. In 1983, just 33 years ago, there was a man named T.K. Jones that was flying around the country giving high-level briefings. He was the Undersecretary for Nuclear Defense Operations. He was from Boeing Aircraft. His speech and his whole thesis to business leaders is, don't worry about nuclear war, because nuclear war is winnable. There's no problem as long as every American has his own shovel and can dig his own foxhole. You dig a trench, you dig a foxhole about 6 feet deep, and then you take a couple doors from the house and put doors over it, and then leave a little hole at the end where you can crawl in. But where the doors are covering this trench, you pile up at least 3 feet of dirt. If the dirt is at least 3 feet deep, it will protect you from the nuclear cloud drifting over after the initial nuclear exchanges happen. Well, there are several thousand doctors in a group called Physicians for Social Responsibility, PSR. They stopped playing golf on Wednesdays and said, we have to do something about this. This guy is not in an insane asylum somewhere being treated for mental illness. He's in the president's cabinet. He was one of President Reagan's top people, and his views were fundamentally insane. And it took a while for the public to find out this was going on. But when proper scientists found out, they hit the campaign trail. And we had a massive educational program. We were part of that from 1983 to 87 to disabuse people of the idea that nuclear war is winnable as long as we strike first. Well, the same kind of media-driven mythology by paid intellectual prostitutes is being foisted on us week by week in the news media, giving news time to people like T.K. Jones that thought there was no problem with nuclear war. People like, you know, these senators. Senator Inhofe, is it? out of Oklahoma or one of the western states, several of them, they're highly paid Republican prostitutes. Look it up in the dictionary. There's two definitions of prostitute. One is women selling sex or selling sex. The other definition is what our Congress critters are doing, selling their votes for money.
Oh, excuse me.
And do you have a question, Don?
No.
So, unprecedented. David, Professor Griffin, incidentally, Professor Griffin is one of the most highly credible, respected authors in the world. He published like 20 or 30 books on religious mythology and how people come to believe in myths. He was a retired, he's a retired theologian from Claremont School of Theology. And in 2004, somebody gave him a videotape, a video that said, David, you don't need an open mind to understand this. You need a 30% open mind. Just step through the barrier, you need a 30% open mind and a seventh grade science education. That's how easy it is to understand the forensic evidence on 9/11. So he published 10 books on the different facets of the myth, and in 2011, he started working on this climate change book. He recognized that that 9/11 is the myth that's driving the global military machine of America that is destroying the environment in huge swaths of land with bombs, missiles, 800 bases spewing all kinds of toxic stuff into the air. So we puncture the myth of 9/11 and we free up $1 trillion a year, more or less, to start spending on what his next book. His next book is called Climate Crisis, I think, or Climate, you can Google it. I don't even have a Xerox copy of the write-up. It's coming out later in October. He's got a small book talking about what citizens can do to help America develop World War II type of global mobilization. They made 138 cars, some number like that, between 1941 and 1945. The auto industry, the automotive industry in this country and other big industry, they tooled up fast. They stopped making cars for Americans and they started making planes and trucks for the military. In 4 years, we had a World War II mobilization, and they accomplished a huge amount where people said, well, that's impossible, that can't be done. Well, they did it. It's in their history books. So all the information and the material we need for a mobilization on the climate crisis, it's all here now. Other countries are putting up solar panels and wind machines as fast as possible. We teach seventh graders, science students, that they're actually putting up little wind machines and solar panels on suburban schools all over the western side of Chicago and out in the suburbs. They're teaching seventh graders that the future is solar and wind power. So if anybody wants any information on any of this kind of stuff, feel free to call me. My phone number is on here. Also, I am available to do presentations like this on different subjects. If you want a presentation on the cutting edge of home energy efficiency, about how to build houses without furnaces like they have in Schaumburg, give me a call. This is, incidentally, it's 1979. This would be the 37th anniversary of the houses in Schaumburg that had no furnace that heat for $10 a month. The media in Chicago has been blacking that out for 35 years. Because those houses cost the same and they have no furnace. They have a tiny heating system because they replace the furnace with insulation in the walls. It doesn't lose heat. And an extra layer of glass in the windows. They made the house tight like a thermos bottle and they put in a fresh air exchanger with a filter in it. You bring in two little bathroom fans running 24 hours a day, 18 watts apiece, they'll run off a couple square feet of solar cells on the roof. Fresh air coming in, the old stale air is going out. And you have a guaranteed annual heating bill of $100 a year for a two-story house. 1979. This is not new knowledge. This is part of the media blackout on things that would cut into utility company profits. They want our cards and letters and $100 bills coming in every month. They want people to know that you can cut your lighting bill by 85% in one day with a trip to Home Depot. You can cut your refrigeration bill by 75% in one day with a trip to Home Depot or invest in a new refrigerator. Incidentally, the money you invest there will give you 5 times or 10 times faster rate of return on that money than keeping it in a treasury bill or a CD or an interest. Energy efficiency, many things are way more efficient. Better investment than what we normally think of. Down here, I already mentioned, in category number 2, the military industrial complex in this country, it's a $1 trillion a year budget that is, if you add it all up, it's bankrupting America. We have politicians saying we can't afford affordable college in this country. We can't help people with medical bills. We have no money for roads and schools except for the Illinois Tollway. Maybe that's a government project where they're pouring billions in, where the state of Illinois has no money. If we weren't doing a singular event, America's number one, if we weren't doing something no other country on the planet is doing, is pouring our money down a military rat hole rather than spending it on things that help people live better. Buckminster Fuller, the architect, said, we could have a design science revolution of a living read. He called it living read. Living, anything related to helping people live better rather than a killing industry. We have a killing industry in this country with the military and the large corporations that manufacture and support all the senators that vote for the military industrial complex every year. So they pour, you know, Smedley Butler, I don't have a copy of that book. General Smedley Butler wrote a book called War is a Racket. You might be able to get it in the library now because the updated version, it's listed in there in the books and number 2, War is a Racket. William Rivers Pitt wrote a book, published this in 2003, The Greatest Sedition is Silence. And he said that he wrote this as a book of memory. 3 years into the Bush administration, he said, I still remember what America was like before they began to convert it. And he said, he's quoted many times the famous quotes from all over the world, all that's necessary for evil to triumph is for good people to sit back and do nothing. And that's where we are. We outnumber people like T.K. Jones, 1,000,000 to 1. We outnumber those people 1,000 to 1, the scientists in 1967 that were promoting nuclear power. They thought we could absorb 1 Chernobyl per year on American soil in exchange for cheap electricity. They said that with a straight face in 1967. 1 reactor accident per 1,000 years of service. So by the year 2000, we're going to have 1,600 reactors running on American soil. Well, the public is just going to have to get used to 1 blast a year and a few 1,000 dead in exchange for cheap electricity. It's right there in the archives. And then a whole bunch of scientists, nuclear scientists, resigned from promoting nuclear power, and they became whistleblowers and hit the campaign trail. That was when being a whistleblower didn't get you arrested under the Homeland Security Act, like what we have now. For those of you that didn't know that, President Obama has, the Obama administration has prosecuted more military whistleblowers than all other previous presidents combined. If you blow the whistle on some crime against humanity that our military is doing, which is spreading large crimes against humanity all over the planet, you don't get rewarded for following the military code of justice, which says you have a duty to disobey orders to your superior. If they tell you to kill a bunch of civilians, and it's obviously a war crime, you have a duty to disobey it. Well, if you try to disobey that, you get arrested and sent to the brig. For those of you that are not familiar with what our military has been doing since Vietnam, an author named Nick Turse is an author that's written about our military for a while now. This book, I think, came out, I want to say 2013 or 2014. Let me look, because 2013 this came out, with updated information about what's going on in Iraq. The book is called Kill Anything That Moves, and it's not listed in this list, number two category, the military-industrial complex. It's not listed there. He talked about, the title is Kill Anything That Moves, The Real American War in Vietnam. I'm a Vietnam veteran, so I experienced some of what he's talking about. I can testify to that if anybody wants any info. What he's talking about is the press. Those of you that are old enough to remember or have looked in the archives, there was something called the My Lai Massacre. Does anybody remember that?
Yes.
I remember reading about it.
Well, people have read about it. You know, most, I don't expect anybody here was at My Lai, but I mean, the My Lai Massacre, with some pictures, was leaked out and reported by the press, and it was presented to us as Lieutenant Calley and his men just went wild one day and they killed a bunch of people. It was an aberration. It wasn't what our heroic troops were doing all over Vietnam. They were fighting for freedom and justice. This book says, he's interviewed with numerous Vietnam veterans, and he said the My Lai Massacre was not an abnormality. That was the order of the day among many, many companies all up and down Vietnam. We slaughtered a couple million Vietnamese and a whole bunch of people in Cambodia too, and the American public never knew. I was an aircraft mechanic as far as radio repair. Bill Lee claimed to be an aircraft mechanic in the Air Force. I was in the Army, and I spent my time fixing bullet holes where the wire, the bullets broke the wire that goes through the tail boom and everything of helicopters. We worked on Huey helicopters. I was a radio repairman. So we had a van that was in a small bunker, so we could be doing listening to the generals giving the orders on who to fire on at night while the choppers were up in the air. Well, one night, we all ran for the bunker when the sirens went off, and the pilots run to the flight line. They might get the dogs, would give us 30 or 40 seconds warning, because the dogs had a sixth sense. They knew when something was coming in, so the dogs on the base would start barking, and they, you know, they were like psychics. So I'm alive today because of the ability of dogs to give you early warning if there's going to be a fire or explosion. Who knows how they do it, but they sense things. Anyway, we all ran to the bunker and we put our headsets on. We're listening on the radio. We're listening to the conversation between our chopper pilots and Italian headquarters. And it's dark. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning. And one chopper pilot says, we can see out in the jungle there where it's dark. We can see where those rockets and mortars are being fired into our big base. Said, permission to fire. Permission. We need permission to fire. They had to get permission to fire on the enemy. Well, they came back and the general says, permission denied. Permission denied. And the chopper pilot, more than one, asked, we can see where these rockets are coming from. They're coming into our base. We'd like permission to fire on the enemy and take them out. Permission to, you know, permission denied. So I got a hold of the crew chief the next day. And I said, he's a friend of mine, and I said, you were on one of those flights last night, right? He said, what the hell was that all about? He said, oh, you don't understand. We already, earlier in the day, we met our kill quota. We can't just go out and fire on the enemy wherever we see him. No, no, no. We have a kill quota, and then we come back and have beer and pizza. He said, if we were able to fire on the enemy wherever we see him, this would be over in a few weeks. And that is when I started reading everything I could get my hands on. That's why I read and study things that are blacked out by the mainstream media. If the American people had known that, they would have gone ballistic. And how many, well, it was 58,000 lives officially were lost, but how many Vietnam veterans came back with all kinds of problems? The Iraqi war veterans are coming back with worse problems. We had something called Agent Orange in Vietnam. They sprayed that defoliant all over the jungles, and it had something called dioxin in it that causes cancer and all kinds of health problems. Hello?
No, I'm sorry. I was going to get the waitress's attention. Heather?
Yeah, I'll be right there.
Is there a question back there?
He's just trying to get the waitress's attention, okay. So we're
I was
cool.
Talking to these two in the corner there. Anyway, One of the best movies, if you want to understand the insanity of the military, industrial, commercial, corporate mind, my favorite movie of all time is a thing called Dr. Strangelove. And it just describes the essence of the insanity of what General Butler talked about. War is a racket, and war exists for rich people, billionaires, to make money selling war material. They make more profit selling shoes and clothes and everything else to the military during the war than they do during peacetime. So every now and then they have to have a little war where you clear the shelves off of all the military stuff that's gathering dust. You know, if you got you have a full quota of bombs, missiles, and bullets and everything. You have to have like an after Christmas sale. You have to dump that stuff on some country and have a little war, and then the military-industrial complex that, you know, gets hundreds of billions of dollars a year for selling stuff to the military, they crank up and keep the production going. And these production facilities are scattered throughout the United States so that virtually every senator and congressman has some facility with a rich owner that can bribe them to keep the operation going. There's some kind of plane, the F-35 or something, it's cost them hundreds of billions of dollars, and it has fundamental flaws. They're never going to be able to protect it, but they keep pouring money down the military rat hole. So these things are all linked together by the media in America that don't tell us what's going on. If we had media that told us what was going on, we could move forward. The third item on down this list here, our third segment, is going to be what I talked about, the corporate controlled media. I missed one of the books. There's a woman called Christina Borgeson. It's listed in the third category down there in the books. It's a book called Into the Buzzsaw. It's a paperback a little thicker than this. She collected the stories of 18 or so Pulitzer Prize winning journalists and published that book in 2004. She described how each of those people had decent careers and everything. A lot of them had Pulitzer Prizes, and they got fired in blackball one day for trying to report a story that they didn't know was taboo or even radioactive. There are some stories, a lot of stories are taboo, and you could get reprimanded or lose your job or get moved to Alaska or out of Mongolia or somewhere else and still keep your job. But there's certain stories in America that are absolutely radioactive. On that one flyer that has a golden triangle on it, those three, you know, if you try to talk about the reality of any of those three on the air, it'll cost you your job virtually instantly. And there's another one now. These books are talking about the real third rail, where it's instant career suicide, total career suicide for a journalist in America if you try to criticize Israel, who is influencing our Congress to vote for certain things that benefit Israel but don't benefit anybody else in the Middle East. Israel has ties to Jewish people that own and control our media. And if you try to talk about that anywhere, if you're a journalist, you're history, you're gone. So this is why none of our Congress people are senators. They depend on support from billionaires and others that give them money to get reelected. There's a thing called AIPAC that is a Jewish organization that will go after and pour money into getting a senator removed from office if they criticize Israel. You can lose in the next primary. They just remove you from office. They don't care what kind of a brain dead person is running against you. They will go after your seat, Senator or Congress, if you criticize Israel. There's a whole list of books on that. I have not been following that subject as much over the last 30 years as I have some of these others, but I can tell you the database is emerging and it's in a bunch of different places. Did somebody have a question back there?
I do.
What?
I think a lot of, would you say a lot of Christians support Israel in Congress?
It depends on what kind of Christian.
Breathing.
What?
Breathing.
Breathing.
Well, breathing. Upright.
Well, in the Bush administration, your Christians were divided into basically two groups, the pro-Christ Christians and the Antichrist Christians. And the Antichrist Christians were the ones that supported the top 10 evil things that the Bush administration was doing under the name of, you know, fighting for Jesus around the world. So you have to differentiate. There are different groups, just like Saudi Arabia cranks out from these madrasas, the schools. They crank out Muslims that are taught to hate, and that's not the main body of Muslims all over the world. You know, so that we should do a talk on this some night. Put together a program, collect information, and we'll look at which Christian groups have been supporting the illegal occupation of the Palestinian territories and the brutality of. Israel is widely recognized around the world to be running one of the largest open-air prisons in the world with the Palestinians. None of that gets on the mainstream news in America, but it's on the alternate sites. Look on Common Dreams. Look on Truth Out. Look at, there's a new site. Is it on here? The Empire Files. If you guys haven't seen The Empire Files with Abby Martin, I would bookmark that on your computer and go watch some of those videos. If you don't have time to read 50 or 100 books on a subject produced by scientists or generals or whoever it is, watch one of those hour and a half videos that are tremendous summaries with high credibility. Yeah, you have a question again?
No, a statement. I think you should state that Jews do not own the media. I'm a Jew, and I do not own any TV station, radio station, newspaper, or anything like that.
Can I answer that real quick? Let me answer that real quick. Okay. He said, just this man over here is a Jew, and since he doesn't own any media, he says my statement that Jewish people own the media is somehow not correct. There are videos that show there are billionaires that are Jewish people that own 99% of the media, radio, and television.
That's
no, it's wrong. Not. This is, hey, if you're not familiar with the data, don't criticize me. Just sit there quietly.
Don't be a Nazi.
I'm not a Nazi. This reaction is what we talk about.
If you, 99%? If you,
well... Over 90. It's up here 95. See, this is what he talked about. This is a third rail issue where people can't handle reality and they will get up and leave. But that's okay, because everybody else is going to stay. Did anybody here see the movie where Jack Nicholson is on the witness stand and A Few Good Men? He says, you can't handle the truth. Remember that? You can't handle the truth. Well, a lot of people can handle the truth. And this is how we move America forward. A lot of Catholics, devout Catholics, could not handle the truth when they were told that their priest was abusing their kids. It's not all priests. He's absolutely right. It's not only 6% of the priests were, abusing kids. And not all Jewish people are abusing people in the Palestine territory. But some of the leaders are, and they're committing large crimes against humanity. Wherever you see crimes against humanity committed by any group of people, we have to stand up and say, that's wrong. We have to move forward. And we teach our seventh graders in solving science projects, the first thing, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the problem and correctly identify the solution. And if only one person walked out of here tonight and everybody else could handle the truth, I consider that an overwhelming success, because we're talking about things that go against the mythological beliefs that are ingrained in us if we've been living under the media bubble. And I agree with, a lot of you would say, well, that's a shock. How can that be true? I said the same thing when our crew chief told me, oh, we can't fire on the enemy every now and then. We got a kill quota. We met our quota, we come back to the base, have some beer and pizza, then go out and kill some more next day. You know, and this is how it dragged on. I sensed that that was a controlled slaughter, that it wasn't any kind of a normal war when I was there. And I learned more as I got back. I was on the ground in Vietnam for 2 years, and I had two tours of duty between 1966 and 68. And what happened in Vietnam is still being suppressed by the mainstream media because we have a $1 trillion a year military budget. We have 5% of the world's people, $1 trillion a year roughly, if you add it all up. It's a prescription for national bankruptcy. Was it Reverend Jesse Jackson that was quoted? No, I'm sorry, Reverend Martin Luther King. He had a famous quote that said, any society that spends more money on the military and the machinery of death than it spends on social issues is approaching spiritual death. And that's where we are. But you wouldn't know that there's millions and millions of people working on good things, trying to promote solutions all over the world and all over America. You'll find that there's a site, is it not here? Incidentally, this yellow flyer I'm working with is like 2 days old. My brother and I just put this together about what we consider the best of the best of current things that people can go to. I haven't memorized it fully yet. I've been working with these sites for several years. I've been working with Common Dream since 2000, 2001. But the Want to Know Info site, I never see any advertisements or references of that. It's like a total media blackout because that Want to Know Info, there's 12 different disciplines on that site. It's the single most hope-filled site that I know of. They're constantly talking about beneficial things that are going on in the automotive industry, the energy industry. You wouldn't know that a professor in Michigan developed a new automotive engine that gets 4 times more energy out of the gasoline or whatever it is. It just increases the mileage from 30 miles to the gallon to 120. It's a type of engine that has fewer moving parts and a rotating disc that compresses the gas. So rather than about 15% of the energy of the gasoline being converted to axle power, it converts 60% of the energy. Now that was developed a year and a half ago and we haven't heard anything since. I don't know if the man is still alive or if the automotive industry bought it out. You had a question?
What's his name?
I don't know. It dropped out of sight. I haven't been able to find any reference. I wasn't following it. It was on the Want to Know Info site. There's a whole bunch of different names of scientists developing free energy machines and all kinds of stuff. I can tell you the name of a car company that developed a 98 mile per gallon little diesel back in 1980. They were basically testing a 100 mile per gallon car that could go from coast to coast on 130-gallon tank. That's Volkswagen. And look at what happened to Volkswagen when they tried to cheat on the emissions to sell more cars. So, you don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater, but the current world record on mileage, I think, they have an annual competition with Shell. So I think some college built some kind of thin machine that would, get over 1,000 miles to the gallon, or it's either 1,000 or 10,000 miles to a gallon around a test track. But you can look that up. World record mileage. They've been building houses without furnaces from Canada and Germany all the way down to the equator since 1977. We're coming up on the 40th year now, next year, of the knowledge that we don't need to burn a lot of fossil fuel for buildings. Buildings can be made very efficient. There's a retrofit program going on. But another thing, I'll just mention this. I told you about the corporate blackout. This book, With Enough Shovels, by Robert Scheer, was published in 1983. You might look and see if a library still has it or if you can download it online. It's called With Enough Shovels, Reagan, Bush, and Nuclear War. There's the quote. Dig a hole, cover it with a couple of doors, and then throw 3 feet of dirt on top. It's the dirt that does it. If there are enough shovels to go around, everybody's going to make it. There's no problem with nuclear war. Today we consider that, the doctor said, here's a man that is an example of insanity on the hoof. Prime beef, as it were. There you are. These people are not in insane asylum somewhere. They're recruited for special jobs into the president's cabinet of right-wing senators, congressmen, politicians. This is what we've gotten since Ronald Reagan was elected in 1980. Incidentally, for those of you that are interested in the history of nuclear power, this book, Energy and War, Breaking the Nuclear Link, published in 1980, listed Commonwealth Edison as technically bankrupt in 1980 with no hope of paying for the nuclear power plants by selling kilowatts. They recognized that the cost of the program was higher than any money you could get by selling kilowatts. The nuclear industry would have to be propped up with massive, massive welfare, which it is. You know, the nuclear industry has been propped up by one of the largest industrial welfare programs in the world. Hundreds of billions of dollars of welfare money has gone to prop these things up way beyond their expiration dates. So, the future belongs to solar and wind power. There's no debate on that now. The knowledge is spreading.
I would tend to.
We have, well, as I tried to make the point earlier, you can always have a debate if you can get somebody from the Flat Earth Society or in a religious cult that has been sucked into a cult and has closed their minds to what's going on out in the real world. And I was a member of a cult myself once. I believed nuclear power was our salvation back in 1979. I converted a house to all electric heat. We were not going to burn any gas at all. We had electric water heater. We were going to get cheap.
Too cheap to meter.
Too cheap to meter kilowatts from ComEd. I was younger then by 35 years, and then I started to read. And when like Professor Griffin said, you need a 30% open mind, step through the barrier, the psychological barrier, and begin to look at the evidence. And the evidence, you don't need anything beyond a 7th or 8th grade education to understand the evidence. But the hard part is facing up to the reality that you have to step through the barrier when people give you evidence, or summaries of evidence, summaries of facts put out by thousands of scientists that counteract your view. You have to step through the psychological barrier and just say, well, I'll take a look at this with an unbiased mind and see what it shows. And then if you do that, you look at all kinds of scientific progress, published data, and you come back and say, as Bill Lee did last week, well, the scientists are all morons. They don't know what they're talking about. They got PhDs, professor emeritus from this university, distinguished professor with 30 years experience here. Well, they're idiots, they're morons. Well, Ed Schultz summed it up the best. If you're going to win a debate and you can't combat the body of facts, somebody's trying to give you facts and you're trying to win a debate, you stand at the microphone and lie your ass off until the clock runs out. That's it. And this is what Rush Limbaugh is, a genius at that. Man's an absolute genius. He can take any kind of corrosive bullshit and make it sound like common sense for the ordinary person on the fly. And he's on, what, hundreds of stations nationwide. The right-wing billionaires that own the media, they feed us wall-to-wall mythology on certain subjects. Last week, we had a media circus last week on all channels, 24/7. All you saw was memorials about remember 9/11, remember 9/11, remember 9/11. Well, I'll just give you a couple of titles here. Here's one called Mounting Evidence, Why We Need a New Investigation into 9/11 by Paul Rea. This was published. The quote he has, he said, Muslims around the world, other people around the world, they don't hate America because of our freedom. They hate our military. They're killing their citizens and clearing people off the land, going for oil. Here's a book that was published in this came out in 2005. Webster Griffin Tarpley is recognized as a highly credible researcher. The book was called 9/11 Synthetic Terror, made in the USA. There's a ton of books have been published from all over the world since 2003, 2004, talking about how each piece of what we were told about 9/11 is physically impossible by the laws of physics and gravity to have happened that way, but mathematically impossible too. Professor Griffin's revised and updated edition is called 9/11 Debunking. Debunking 9/11 Debunking. This is a response to a book put out by Popular Mechanics that was trying to debunk all the authors, the scientists, the physicists that were saying what really happened. Well, he put it together in four sections. He gives you the easy to understand mental process where you can understand the evidence of how we were fed the big lie. Here's a book by Kevin Ryan. It's called Another 19. It's published recently, last couple of years. Another 19, Investigating the Legitimate 9/11 Suspects. And it's got pictures and write-ups. They're publishing pictures now of the main 19 people that played the key roles orchestrating the event of 9/11. Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, Rice, Richard Pearl, Douglas Feith, Wolfowitz, Donald Rumsfeld, the people in key positions to orchestrate the events of that day, another 19. So those 19 names are being listed now among the international war crimes tribunals that want to prosecute and go after the people that did it.
What's the title on that one?
The title on this book was Another 19, Investigating Legitimate 9/11 Suspects. It's written by Kevin Robert Ryan. Kevin Ryan is one of the key researchers that have been involved in 9/11. Kevin Ryan got reprimanded. He worked at the Underwriters Laboratories, and he sent a note out asking for clarification because the government had put out a report saying that the steel in the towers that have been certified to withstand 2,000 degrees of heat for 4 hours, that steel melted in 30 minutes. And so he working for Underwriters Laboratories, testing this stuff, he knew that that government report was false, and he sent out an email asking for clarification, and it cost him his job at Underwriters Lab. People have been getting fired from universities around the country in laboratories and things in America for trying to promote or talk about the forensic evidence that shows that 9/11 was a complete myth. This one, Jim Mars is one of our best investigative reporters. This is a book called The Terror Conspiracy Revisited. He published an earlier one called Inside Job. Many investigative reporters have been publishing books with titles like that, Inside Job, and you know they've known very early on, since 2003, a lot of the investigators, that the official story was a crock. This is new. It says Jim Fetzer out of Minnesota and Mike Palak, they published this book, just came out a couple months ago, called America Nuked on 9/11. Their research is in agreement with Professor Judy Wood out of Clemson that published this physics textbook in 2010, I think it was. The title of this book is with a picture on the front. It's called Where Did the Towers Go? started copyright 2005. She started publishing this work in 05, and it evolved with pictures of what the Trade Center looked like right afterwards, and the damage to toasted cars that looked like they were irradiated on one side by some giant microwave oven or something, where the aluminum was melted down. But anyway, the thesis of her book is, where do the towers go? Because they didn't collapse to the ground. What they showed us on TV, all of the news media, with the reporters reading or writing, laying down the official Hollywood script of 9/11. The event was scripted because they were talking about, look at how the building is falling down. You know, and they interviewed a man on the street, said, oh, it was so hot, the steel just melted, and poof. They laid down the official story of 9/11 in the first 2.5 hours. But people thought for years that the two twin towers had collapsed. They didn't. They went sideways in the wind as a cloud of fine powdery dust, where a lot of the dust was, the particles were smaller than a red blood cell. Now this was published, this book in the physics textbook form came out in 2010. She didn't make any distinction. She's not accusing anybody of who did it. She just said, this is the forensic evidence. This is why you need to investigate who had the means, motive, and opportunity, which is this book here by Mamadou Chinoglu. I can't pronounce his name. It's called Means, Motive, and Opportunity. Who in the Bush administration had the means, motive, and opportunity, and probable cause? The subtitle is Probable Cause for Indicting George W. Bush, His Sponsors, and Aides for the attack of September 11th. Means, motive, and opportunity. It's kind of a, this means, motive, and opportunity, or motive means an opportunity, is a companion book to this one, Another 19. You digest these two, and it'll give you a decent background overview of the people that were appointed in key positions of the Bush administration for the first 9 months. Yes?
You're supposed to be talking about 10 things on this list. So far, 90% of what you're talking about is 9/11 as a conspiracy. We don't need that. We get your idea. You've told us that 20 times. Why don't you move on to the list and do the other 10 things?
Good job.
The gentleman in the front said a list of 10 things was published, but those were older. The list of 10 things on this list are from the 2014 booklet. Charlie printed these in here, but Charlie wanted me to present a current updated presentation with things that are happening right now and being blacked out right now. And that's why one of the most important things that was blacked out last Saturday was the conference in New York. Anybody heard about the conference, the two-day conference at Cooper Union? That's not even on the write-up, because that happened. It was a group of worldwide experts, people talking about climate change. A lot of the things on this top 10 list from 2014 were talked about, and what we can do to prevent move solutions forward in that conference last weekend at Cooper Union. But they were also talking about, how do we move the nation forward from 9/11? The worldwide consensus among countries is, you can't move forward until you face that issue and arrest and prosecute the people that did it. Because they're going to keep promoting the myth, we'll keep destroying the environment, we'll keep climate change the first thing on this list. We could free up $1 trillion to solve that problem. I talked about it. Number two, our patriotic soldiers are not fighting for freedom and justice. Number three, America doesn't have a free press. We've been talking about that. The American system of capitalism is not the best way to run a country. We talked about that early on.
You didn't talk about the last two you mentioned.
Did you miss the talk I've been giving tonight? I've been talking about censored news.
I was late, so.
Well, we talked about, let me finish the talk, please. We talked about, a lot of the complaints you have, we already talked about, okay? So let's, in the rebuttal period, or the questions and answer period, anybody has questions and answers or something that they would like to hear covered?
Just a second, listen, if I may, Andy, I'd just like to say to everybody, I know Andy invited comments, I want to ask that before you, that if you had something you want to say, just raise your hand. Okay, that's all.
Let's,
So we're going to wrap up in a couple of minutes. Here's another one that's on the list. I brought a book to talk about it. That's number 6 on this top 10 list. There's a global consensus that fracking, in America, fracking is responsible for a massive number of earthquakes and destruction in states that had no earthquakes before they started fracking.
Oh, okay.
Earthquakes are everywhere.
Number 7 on that list really doesn't need much. All you need to do is look at the news of the last week talking about the poster child for our medical system, the billionaire company that raised the price of EpiPens from $10 or $12 a pen on up to $600 a pair. The message that our for-profit medical system, by their actions, what they say to Americans is, we are sorry you're dying because you can't afford the medicine. It's nothing personal, but we need our billions. I'm sorry that some of my some people would be saved by using the medicine my company makes. I'm sorry those people are dying or already died, but they couldn't afford it. And my number one goal is to make profits. If people can't help me be a multi-billionaire, then they don't deserve to live. That's the message that the for-profit, capitalist-driven medical system is sending to Americans, and we're the only country on earth sending that message. Ted talked last week, number 8 on this list, incidentally, was talked about 2 weeks ago with Ted Aranda. If you had been here and seen that speech, I didn't want to go over that because Ted covered it. There's no large groups of terrorists anywhere in the world that hate Americans. There are small pockets of terrorism that are created by our drones killing their weddings and that kind of stuff. The military drone program worldwide is not protecting American freedoms at all. And the evidence is emerging on that. We could do a 2-hour presentation on that some night.
Okay.
And the number 10 thing I already mentioned, the globe. So we basically covered the top 10 on this list throughout this presentation tonight. And the last thing I would leave you with, those portal websites, if you wanna be an informed consumer of news, start logging on to Common Dreams and TruthUp, and they will. Those the two books I showed. This changes everything, and the one unprecedented. These two books are loaded with references. Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything, and Unprecedented: Can Civilization Survive the CO2 Crisis? These two are loaded with references. So you don't have time, you don't have to really comb through another 40 or 50 books to get the gist of what really hundreds of thousands of scientists all over the world are saying on a variety of subjects. Okay, I guess we'll start the questions and answers.
All right, let's have a big hand for our speaker. Okay, all right.
One second, I forgot to mention one book I forgot to mention that is about tonight. Greg Palast is another investigative reporter. His book is called The Best Democracy Money Can Buy. And it talks about our political system. It's very current right now about the billionaires buying and selling to politicians. The best democracy money can buy, that's what we have in America.
Okay. All right, let's move on to the questions. Now, just if you have a question, I'd like, again, raise your hand. Again, I want to just remind everybody, it's time for questions, not for speeches. All questions have to end with a question mark. All right, Dan, go ahead.
Okay. I just want to say, I didn't mean to call you names. I'm really sorry I said that.
Okay, thank
you. Number 2, I think people can have a difference of opinion would still agree on the purpose. I like what you're doing, Andy. You should keep doing it. All right, number three.
Yeah, this would make a good rebuttal. Excuse me, Dan, if I may interrupt you, okay. You have a question?
Let him finish.
Let's have the question.
The question is, I have a question.
Come back, man.
Come on.
No, listen.
One fuller.
Have you heard of Greg Grandin?
No.
He writes something like, he writes history.
Okay.
I don't know who Greg Grandin is, so I can't make a comment.
All right, all right.
If I don't know what something is, I won't make a comment on it.
All right.
Okay.
All right, let's, all right, Carl.
Kind of give me this impression that we shouldn't trust mainstream media, you know, by these books, but are any of these books published by mainstream media?
The question is, are any of these books published by mainstream media? Pretty much no. These are in the alternate press, or where people aren't getting a huge amount of money, they're not getting rich. A lot of these books are published by what you would call smaller publishing houses, or the alternate press, where the mainstream media that publishes Tom Clancy and Danielle Steele and all of those, they won't publish books like this. And that's why you see the shelves at Barnes & Noble inundated with, you know, the glittery fiction and stuff, the big names, where you have to hunt for these books back on the shelves of the current event. Incidentally, you can go into a lot of Barnes & Noble stores and ask the people at the front counter, you know, that work there, hey, where do I find the Project Censored book? And they don't know about Project Censored. That's how good the blackout is. Barnes & Noble has it on a shelf back there, and the media up front don't even know that it's a bestseller every year.
They sell
thousands of copies.
Yeah, one list.
Charlie, one fool at a time, no heckling. Doug Binkley, do you have a question?
I didn't hear a lot about this number six, about fracking is not providing cheap energy.
Okay, the question was, I'll give you a 30-second summary. Fracking does not provide cheap energy, for one thing. Fracking is not about energy, it's about destroying water tables to provide a new gold rush for clean water. Once you destroy wells under farmers' lands, they have to buy from the pipeline of water that's being piped into there. There's the Bush administration, George Bush, his family bought 98,000 acres of land in a little quarter of Paraguay where there's nothing going on there. That 98,000 acres sits over the last largest aquifer of fresh water in the world. These people are planning to go into the water business after the oil business has been shut down. So there's a global consensus that we have to leave oil in the ground if Manhattan isn't going to be under 30 feet of water in this century. That's how fast it's happening with global warming and climate change.
Okay, Charlie, did you have a question?
Yes. Let's say I'm the editor of a newspaper or producer of a TV station or I own a radio station. A town of 50,000. How do I know what news is censored and what isn't? How is it transmitted to me as the editor of the newspaper with a daily publication coming up? How do I know what's been censored and what's not?
Well, just from reading the paper, you wouldn't know because it's not there. You wouldn't know that there's a bunch of people that have been building houses in Chalmers since 1979 with no furnace because it's not in the paper.
I'm the editor.
Yeah.
I get newspapers. I have to assign.
Oh, reports. You're an editor. How do you know what's censored from others?
How do I know what is okay and what isn't?
Oh, you find as soon as you try to publish, you'll find out as soon as you publish something controversial. You know, you'll hear about it from other people. Here, I'll give you an example.
Hold on, wait a minute. I put out an edition.
You put out an edition.
What happens?
What happens is other papers from the New York Times on down will attack you if you're talking about something they don't want American people to know about. Look up the history of what happened in the San Jose Mercury.
They are going to publish what? Articles or attacking me
as an editor?
They'll attack the reporter and they'll attack the editors. They're saying they made a terribly bad decision to publish a story that had no basis in reality. They gave a false impression.
Do you have examples of such articles?
Oh, yeah.
From the New York Times?
Yeah.
How many? What topic?
There's a bunch over the years. There's a database full of them. I've been talking about this for 10 years, Charlie.
I just don't know what's okay and what isn't until I just hope and wait and see.
If you're an editor, you can go on for years reporting local news and never get any flack. But if you, like the San Jose Mercury is a famous example. Gary Webb was a reporter. He wrote a story about the CIA running drugs in Los Angeles. And the San Jose Mercury vetted it because the evidence was overwhelming. The crack cocaine problem.
What was that name's reporter again?
Gary Webb.
I'd like to see your database of articles from the New York Times of censored stories.
I want to see this.
Charlie, this is the article from the New York Times. And I've never seen such an article.
Because you haven't been looking.
I've been reading it for 35 years.
You've been standing in a blizzard, claiming you can't see a single snowflake. You do this
okay,
every time.
Second.
Hey. Standing in a blizzard, I don't see a thing.
Okay. Gary, all right. This is a time for questions, not arguments between our web developer and our speaker. Okay?
Well, I'm worried about that.
All right, Charlie, we got another question here. Tim, what's your question?
Yeah, I'm wondering. I look at like a lot of the same things you do about the development of solar and wind, about nuclear power, about climate change. How is it that I could be convinced that I see our future with a key component of nuclear power being involved with it, and you see that there is none involved with it? I mean, I
can answer your question.
Okay.
You are where I was before I started to read and look at the evidence. If you're honest and you look at the evidence, first thing you say, well, that can't be true. That's counter to what I believe. And then you look for another source. And you look for another source. And finally, you find that no Wall Street investment broker or bank, nobody backs nuclear power with private money. Number one, it's uninsured and uninsurable. Number two, and as I pointed out, in energy, where's that book?
Okay.
This book, the science of nuclear power has been solid since 1980. There's a chapter in here that says reactors and bombs, reactors as bomb factories. If you're running a nuclear reactor of any kind, you automatically have expertise and a pipeline to order stuff on the on the business market. You can order all the material necessary, the metals processing, grinding machines, whatever it is. If you run one nuclear reactor, it's a facade for a nuclear bomb program, or can be used that way, and it's seen that way all over the world. Also, just the current raw numbers in the last year, the current raw numbers of kilowatts coming out of wind machines and kilowatts coming out of solar power indicate that a blend of solar and wind power is at least 5 times, probably 10 times cheaper than any kind of nuke you could build, and it'd be 10 times faster to get the kilowatts. Those are the actual economics. So you have to step, like I said earlier, you've got to step through the psychological barrier and forget everything you knew. Like I had to do that in 1980. I was pro-nuclear. Forget everything you believed in the past and say, what's this crazy guy named Amory Lovitz talking about? And there you are. And then you find other scientists, and there's a whole bunch. It's a whole new world. And that would be my suggestion. Okay. You got a question?
Okay, so yeah. Andy, excuse me. Yeah. Excuse me for interrupting, but Andy, the moderator calls on questioners. Andy, I said the moderator
don't
called.
Don't do that, Donna. We're going to have a problem.
Okay, Andy. Right,
okay, just.
You want me to keep it cool?
No. Keep it cool. Good guys.
You get the free dinner, but I can moderate
Andy,
myself.
Andy, calm down.
No.
Calm down, Andy. Okay, ma'am, go ahead.
Yeah, you know, I mean, there all of this issue about nuclear power, and everybody, I mean, there's a lot of things that we can't even define. But the question is, who controls the uranium source for this nuclear power? Yeah, I mean, you're going to have the same kind of situations. You have the water problem in Uruguay, and you're going to have the same situation as you do with the EpiPen here in the States, kicking the price up to $600. Now, Tim, I suggest that you start doing the research and find out who...
Did you have a question?
I'm asking the question.
Okay.
Who controls the uranium source?
The question then asked, I'll answer it for everybody. Who controls the sources of uranium? I can tell you it's not small mom and pop organizations in any countries. It's big billionaire owned companies. And they are part and parcel. Those companies are part and parcel of what Naomi Klein talked about in her first book called The Shock Doctrine. It talks about predatory capitalism, where you get a billionaire predator big enough, and they own a company, they can control the market, or they can merge with a couple other billionaires, and they can charge whatever they want. And in answer to your question, the billionaires that own uranium do not want to see the uranium mine shut down. They're getting an enormous amount of welfare money from governments propping up nuclear power plants. Right? It's just money to them. Like I said, you know, they would say to us, well, we're sorry our uranium dust is poisoning all these people. We're sorry so many lands are contaminated. But it's not, we don't have anything personal against these Indians on the reservation where the uranium mines are. It's nothing personal. I'm sorry they're dying with health problems. It's just business. We have to address that. If we don't address that one thought, well, I'm sorry you're dying, but it's nothing personal. It's just business. That's how America functions, with capitalism, and that's the problem. Right? Does that answer your question?
Not exactly. I mean, I'm thinking...
Well, you can look up the names of the companies that own them if you want to know the specifics.
I understand this. It's just that I remember when Bill Clinton made a deal after he was out of office with somebody in order to tie up uranium mines in, was it Kazakhstan or something?
Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan. Well, they're looking to create monopolies.
That's right.
Monopolies.
And recently, wasn't there some place out in the West where people were killed because of some issue over uranium mines?
Oh, yeah. Protesters are getting killed all over the place, all over the world. And if those of you that hadn't seen it, some protesters got attacked with dogs and mace by a private security company out of the Dakota Pipeline. And Amy Goodman was arrested for trying to film it. So they said that's the first filmmaker in modern memory that's been arrested for trying to film an event. Now, we're in a war. We're in a war for the soul. A lot of these people use that term. They say we're in a war for the soul of humanity. And we're either going to stop polluting the planet and give ourselves a chance to survive the next 100 years, or we're going to be faced with mass migrations of people coming out of poison lands and lands that are underwater, or coastal lands, all over. And next question, Dan.
Okay. Now, Charlie, you have your hand up. Is there anybody else who has a question who has not already asked? Yes, sir.
I need to preface my question with a clarification. I want you to clarify something that you said. I want to make sure I understood that you said that Jews own 99.9% of American media. Did you say
well,
that?
I might have. It might not be 99. The video I saw.
But that's. I just want to make sure
yeah,
you said
I
that.
Yeah, I said that.
I don't want you to talk about that.
Yeah, I said that. That's the impression I got from watching a documentary that listed. They had every major television news station was listed as being owned by Jewish people. I have to research it. If it's not 90% or 95%.
This is my question. If you're going to make something that that inflammatory, I would suggest, I would challenge you to just name the name of just one Jewish person who's on this list of people who own all this media.
Oh.
Just one name.
Sumner Redstone? You know, Sumner Redstone owns, is it ABC or CBS?
I don't know.
I didn't make the list. That's not one of the subjects.
Actually, can I, if I may just answer a little bit. Actually, both CBS is as I recall, owned by the Viacom Corporation, a yet bigger corporation that owns other stuff.
Yep.
ABC is controlled by the Walt Disney Productions. So those are publicly traded
and
corporations.
If you want the information on this, I'll tell you exactly where I got it. Mm-hmm. There's a video.
I don't want you to tell me where to look.
Well, you asked me for a name, and I don't have those names in my brain. They're on a list in a video. They're in books.
That's
right.
That's
if you want to come back next week, I'll give you the list.
Okay.
But don't bug me now for a name.
Okay, all right, guys, we can't have everybody talking at the same time.
I can offer some clarification to a question from a recent New York Times article dated from 11/21/03. At that time, it was Gerald Levin, CEO and director of AOL Time Warner, Michael Eisner, chairman and CEO of the Walt Disney Company, Edward Bronfman Sr., chairman of Sequin Company Limited, Edward Bronfman, president and CEO of Sequin Company Limited, head of Universal Studios, Sumner Redstone, chairman and CEO of Viacom.
Okay.
So on and so forth. It's available out there. And I mean, I'm not trying to say, but there are some validity to what he says based on some evidence. And I can show you after the.
What was the year on AOL Time Warner doesn't exist as a corporation.
Well, this one was done in 2003.
Because I can discuss this, but I don't
want
to. All
right, but that's 13 years old.
Approaching rebuttal session.
All right, Jonathan.
You got the 5 minute rebuttal.
Yeah.
I don't even know how to say that. The list that you presented with has issues of peace, democracy, and justice on Earth of such a magnitude. It seems like all of us in this room could not fall on that trapdoor of divide and conquer and pitting one group against each other. So could we just remember when Brahm was still here, those of you who know Brahm, it's kind of the heart and soul of the college, just not to fall on those trapdoors of divide and conquer of emotionally charged guys.
Right.
My question is exactly on that point too. If we're going to solve all these problems, we have to have a solidarity that's unprecedented. If we're going to prevent a sixth mass extinction, we have to have a first mass solidarity globally. So could you present your vision of what would create a first mass solidarity?
You're asking me that question?
Yes.
To prevent my vision? Well, I would start with this book, Unprecedented. It describes the problem globally. It describes what people are doing all over the world. The last third of the book is loaded with solutions of what people are doing and what needs to be done. And he's putting out another book, a smaller one, that's going to be a $10 book. This is like $25. It's coming out in October. I've already ordered a few. I'll bring it to the college as soon as I get copies. But my vision is a summary of what all these other people are saying, that from all over the world, you need, all of us that understand what's happening need to do the best we can to help other people learn. And then the knowledge spreads, like in Galileo's time, there was no cell phones, no video, no radio, TV. The only way knowledge would spread was from person to person talking to somebody. You had to walk over to their house and sit down and have a cup of coffee or something. If they had coffee, I assume they did. But anyway, on a lot of the information that's in these books is not spreading through the mainstream media. It's spreading through the alternate media of the free sites that are still on the free internet. Truthout, Common Dreams, Smirking Chimp has some tremendous political writers. People with 30, 40 years experience in real journalism. Log on to Greg Palast's site. Greg Palast has a site. Jim Mars has a site. Investigative reporters. Jim Mars has covered all kinds of things, not just the aliens on the moon for Charlie's viewing pleasure there. So there's investigative reporters with high level of credibility everywhere if you know where to look. And that's how, if you find a site, tell somebody about it. Like what we're doing tonight, we published a list of sources you can take with you and start with your own computer at home. Before I had a computer, I was just doing books before there was an internet. You know, Google's only been around since 1998, less than 20 years, basically. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Is that a good
all
answer?
Right. Ilana.
Yeah, excuse me, since this topic, like, sort of like in general.
You have a question?
Yeah. What's your opinion about Uber will start to send the car without drivers? So it's very dangerous, right? I'm not approving.
She asked a question, it's probably a good one. The media is not really talking too much about it. We're still getting stories out in the media about what a benefit it might be to have driverless cars with Uber and some of the others. Personally, I think that's insane.
Yeah.
That with the roads we have and everything else, a computer can do it 99% of the time and without fail, but where you need a human brain is that other 1% where something unusual is happening and somebody has to turn this way or that to avoid a crash. And so I don't think we'll see, we should not see driverless cars on the roads, these roads anyway, anytime soon. You could put them on monorails and you just have a car come by every 5 minutes driving on the rails. I have no problem, like in San Francisco where you have that BART. You know, I think there's unattended cars that go on rails, you know, light rail traffic and, you know, many places.
Okay.
A lot of the ski lifts, you know, they don't have an operator in there. The car just comes along and you get in. And ride.
No way.
Right.
No way.
So anyway,
all right,
other
now,
questions?
Okay, sir, did you have a question?
You made reference to APAC, which is a Jewish organization that funds certain candidates. You said that organization is trying to defeat various people.
Sir, could you speak up, please?
What's your question? I made a statement, but what is your question?
You cannot go to the second point. There's no evidence that APEC tries to defeat candidates unilaterally. There is no evidence, sir, of that. Now, I'm asking, what is your evidence? They do fund people that support their position, but so does the Catholic Church. And you went out of your way to point the finger at the Jews. Why did you point the finger at the Catholic Church and the Protestants? What is in your mind that you walk in here and you walk out with the same goddamn crap in your mind, okay? That's my question.
The man asked a question, and I think we should all extend him the courtesy of having an opinion that is at odds with documented reports from hundreds of other people.
There's no evidence. What the hell is your evidence?
There's a lot of evidence.
The APEC tries to defeat people unilaterally. They support people that are in their position. But what is your evidence that they try to defeat?
All I'm telling you is a lot of these books talk about APEC being, if you try to criticize what certain things are happening in Israel, it's a third rail.
Excuse me.
About what's happening in Israel is bad. All right. Where the hell are you? And why do you sort out the Jews, you goddamn son of a bitch?
All right.
Goddamn son of a bitch.
All right, sir. No name calling. No personal attacks. Now, I just want to say that calling a person a goddamn son of a bitch is a personal attack. Personal attacks are not allowed. And also, I just want to say that this is not a time for arguments. Furthermore, we are out of time for rebuttals. So
for questions, you mean?
Questions. Thank you,
Tim. Going into rebuttals
right,
now.
Right, so we're going to have to... I'm going to take one more question from Wes, who never had a question before, and then we go to rebuttals. Go ahead, Wes.
Are there any governments that you believe are on a correct path?
Oh, the question was a good one. Are there any governments that are on a correct path? Venezuela is one that's been trying to move forward. A lot of governments are being attacked by our military for trying to help get their people off of oil and fossil fuel. The fossil fuel industry has enormous reach around the world. And if governments have friendly elected officials that don't want to go along with the military warmongering coming out of Washington, then our government tries to overthrow those people. So if you want to look at beneficial, one government that's doing a lot of good stuff is Germany. Germany and several countries in Europe. Bangladesh is number one in fastest growing solar installations on the planet. They're just leapfrogging right over fossil fuel and going pure solar. The Want to Know Info site, if you have a computer, the Want to Know Info site has. Are you guys okay back there, or can I talk? It can be.
Where's the line?
A few seconds. In the last week and tonight, we've seen some examples of what for years I've been calling the Catholic Church Syndrome. Where if you went into a church on Sunday, if you went into a church on Sunday and they didn't know that the priest was abusing their kids, and you say, oh, by the way, here's the evidence, the police have it, about half the congregation will close their minds and they will verbally attack you. You're slandering the man. You're a son of a bitch. That can't be true. There's no way this can be true. We hear this on abuse problems. We hear it with child abuse problems. Oh, you're slandering that man. There's no way he could have abused our next door neighbor.
Okay.
People won't face the reality of the evidence right in front of them. And if they've lived with the myth for so long, the longer you live with a myth, the harder it is to face the reality that you've been living with a myth.
Okay.
And that's where we are.
Let's get into rebuttals.
Are you finished? Okay, let's go to rebuttals. All right.
I'm going first.
Now, how many people want to speak? And Jonathan, you want to talk, so that's one, two, everybody who wants to talk, raise your hand. Okay, so far, one, two, three, four, keep them hands up, y'all. Okay, four. Five, six. So let's, 20 minutes each?
Let's go 5 minutes each.
5 minutes. Let's make it four, just to be on the safe side, because we always run over time.
Okay, okay.
4 minutes. Okay.
You know, it is amazing how a man could look at the same evidence that somebody else does and gets an entirely different contradiction. And I'm here to tell you that I think Andy is discounting nuclear power and not giving it its rightful place in our energy mix. I'm going to first tell you about a man by the name of Alvin Weinberg, the director of Oak Ridge National Laboratories, who developed a reactor.
Tim, can you do something about that?
We can get it. I'm sorry. Okay, thanks, Andy. And he was one of the first guys to talk about the global warming crisis, the coming CO2 crisis around the world. And he was the director of Oak Ridge National Laboratories and was instrumental in such things as the Manhattan Project and the development of the light water reactor. He too takes the same views Andy does as being a whistleblower in the nuclear power industry. He was fired in 1973 by the Nixon administration, particularly by a congressman by the name of Chet Holyfield, who does it because he warned about the potential problems that the expanding scale of our nuclear power industry and the light water reactor in particular was designed initially for a submarine. And now it was scaled up so high that it is not the best way to do nuclear power. As I looked into this further, I discovered something that he was working on. It was called the thorium molten salt reactor, which is a better way of doing this power. And they actually had, in the 1960s, ran a molten salt reactor for over 4,000 hours. They've done the basic research. And right now, the U.S. Department of Energy is having some 300 scientists in China work on developing a commercially viable molten salt reactor. There's a firm that Wall Street might be looking at called Flybe Energy that's in the process of developing one. And
in Canada, Terrestrial Power Incorporated, is also looking at one. And there's been a number of nuclear reactor startups that are taking a look at this molten salt technology as a way to help get our energy needs in there. I'm also going to concede that wind and solar are going to have a big part to play, because Andy's claims are absolutely right. The price is coming down. The price is coming down. The amount of research and price per kilowatt's going down. But the wind doesn't always blow and the sun always doesn't shine. And presently what they do to back up the present wind and solar power plants, which currently operate at about full capacity, roughly 30% at a time, they use the natural gas peaker plants. And they're constantly starting and stopping to go with to fill the amount of available gaps in wind. And there have been some studies that say this is a worse way to run one of these plants. We all know we get lower mileage and more carbon emissions when we're in stop-and-go traffic in a city versus country driving when it runs at a more sustained capacity. I am not going to sit here and say that Andy's all wrong, because in a lot of ways he's right. I agree with him on global warming. I agree that there's an energy crisis. I believe, too, that the present way that nuclear is being done is not the best way forward. And yes, it does produce bomb factories and everything else. But there are better ways of doing things. What I would hate to see, with the short-sightedness of a lot of today's anti-nuclear people, is that you need innovation. You need to take a look at the technology coming forward. You need to take a look at what in the past has been done. There are solutions out there. The genie is out of the bottle. And if we don't do it in the United States, China's probably going to be doing it next. And the thing is, if we think we've seen it bad now with our oil, just imagine we have to license our nuclear power technology from China. Thank you very much. Yes.
A couple of years ago, there was some talk about cracking water, splitting water into hydrogen and oxygen, and then using that for fuel.
It's hydrogen economy. What that is you separate water. You have to have power to separate the hydrogen and oxygen. Mm-hmm. And hydrogen can be used in either a fuel cell or burned a lot like natural gas if it's taken care of properly. Now, that, remember, hydrogen has to be made from another source. Your electric cars have to be made from a power plant. You have to have good battery technology to store electricity. The bottom line is that whatever we need, we're going to need an all-of-the-above strategy to do it. Now, frankly, for me, in our energy crisis, the only way I can see us really getting off of fossil fuels totally is with a strong nuclear component. And I know that there's a lot of things out there, but you know, even today, they're talking about a $10 billion upgrade to our electrical grid just to accommodate a lot of the solar and wind plants. They're up right now in Canada where they're allowing a lot of this to happen. They're finding an increasing instability with their clean power in their grid through the phenomenon of electromagnetic renaissance. But anyway, my time is up. It's time for me to get up and let the next rebutter go.
Okay. Okay, you're on, Jonathan.
I'm debating whether to just scrap my rebuttal that I wrote and just talk about the college of complexes. And you know what? I'm going to do that. Is it 4 minutes?
Just go ahead. I'll time you.
All right. This is from Slim Brundage, the founder of the College of Complexes. We also affectionately know him as the janitor. This is a quote by Jack Conroy in 1983, who wrote this book about Buckhouse Square, the Beat Generation, Selective Ravings of Slim Brundage. He said, "Slim ran a lively place, livelier than most. He's an ingenious sort of guy, the typical wobbly type, good at talking and getting people to talk." And I'm thinking about Brahm tonight because I just want you all to know there's somebody who's going to be back stronger than ever. We hope soon. We hope this year before the election, because we all are looking forward to hearing his take on this year's election season. I just want you to know that, you know, this is a free speech forum, and sometimes people say things that are absolutely intolerable and inexcusable, but you have to still give them their due on things
other than that topic, because they might be right on a lot of other shit. This is real talk right now. You know, we all have something really dumb to say in our lives, and I think we can all just let the elephant in the room go. Who cares who owns the media? I don't care. I'm quite certain it's not any one ethnicity, language, religion, nationality. That's what the 1% wants us to do, is to keep our eye off the ball of peaceful, democratic, grassroots movements for system change. So let's not fall on that trapdoor, because that's just what Cheney and Rumsfeld and Bush want. To us, that divide and conquer strategy that we walk right into and pit each other against each other. So think about Brahm. When those issues are, maybe somebody just put their foot in their mouth and didn't mean anything by it, but then the Q&A session came, they put their foot in their mouth two or three other times. So, and this is from somebody whose great-grandfather, John Mazurek, came from Poland to Chicago in 1901 and worked on the railroad, so I'm well aware of the history, and I'm not discounting this in any way or trying to water it down. The serious concerns that were raised, and I empathize with them. But I want to talk about the issues that I do agree on in the 1 minute I have left. Approximately 221 million people are eligible to vote on November 8th, 2016 in the United States presidential election, along with all other local candidates competing for public office. Now, there's a lot of newspaper articles where you can find out about voter irregularity in, quote, the leader in the world on election credibility. These kind of extraordinary failures of leadership to make our elections free and fair, that everybody is counted, they don't happen in societies where the relationship between a people and a government is one that's respectful and honest and cooperating in nature. And if you took a poll in the United States, what the proper definition of our current state would be, and what's happened in the last 35 years to our taxes, to our time, to our trust, to our civil liberties, it may not be that the American people on that poll come to a conclusion that it amounts to treason, but no doubt they would say that we severely lack something that Franklin Delano Roosevelt talked about in this quote, which is security at home. All these rights spell security, and after this war is won, we must be prepared to move forward in the implementation of these rights to new goals of human happiness and well-being. Unless there is security here at home, there cannot be lasting peace in the world. And he was referring to the Second Bill of Rights. Their boogeyman of the Soviet Union is gone in the 1990s, the most useful scapegoat to scare the people had been exposed as no longer legitimate, and now they need new boogeymen. So they're actually creating their own crisis, and financial crisis, war crisis, earth crisis, that allows these corrupt governments, not just the U.S., to continue to claim that they are necessary. So just bear that in mind. Treason is happening, and we can call it treason and agree at least on that issue.
Okay. Next, Trey Potter.
Daniel Weinberg, racist. Okay, so Andy, our speaker tonight, had a story about Vietnam that I think went over a lot of people's heads. He said that he was in Vietnam. I was not in Vietnam, I'm not a veteran. He was in Vietnam. How long were you there? A year, 2 years? 2 years. Yeah, that's 2 years too much. Anyways, it was a helicopter. He was a mechanic, and he heard about the guys who went out to shoot, and they couldn't get permission from the generals to shoot because they had killed already enough enemy that day. They had enough body count, so they couldn't kill any more. But actually, it was 1 a.m, so it was the next day, but I guess they didn't count that. Anyway, so, I mean, that's the insanity of war. So they went back and they had beer and popcorn and saw a good movie, and then they went to sleep, and then they woke up, and then they wouldn't kill some more. So that's the glory of war. These are our heroes. These are the people we have parades for, and we throw confetti, and this man was a great warrior. He killed 75 people. You know, I mean, and that's called America, the great. So what do I have to say? Well, so war in Iraq, the war in Iraq is an old-fashioned American war. That's where actually we went in, and we went in and we told them, we showed them a lesson, we gave them a lesson. Instead of the more common way of, you know, just sort of doing it by public relations and getting their ambassador pissed off and maybe shoot the ambassador. But, you know, when we actually went into a country and actually attacked, that's the old way, like going into the Philippines, going into Cuba, going into Haiti, going into Dominican Republic, going into anywhere else. So now we're doing a new kind of war. But of course, why did we do that? For Candy brought up oil. Well, we have to protect the oil supply in the Middle East. And Iraq is a very popular, very plentiful, a lot of oil. So that's a good place to go. And calling people Nazis, I didn't mean, well, I mean, Nazi is an electric word, and, you know, the Nazis all died 70 years ago, so there are no Nazis in this room or in this restaurant. Probably not, unless they're 90 years old. But actually, my mother had to leave Berlin, Germany in 1934 because the Nazis were there. But the Nazis did a deal with Roosevelt. You know, Hitler and Roosevelt were buddies, so they said, okay, a few kids can come over and we'll save them, but the rest of them, they can die. But anyways, so how much time do I have?
3:40, you got less than about 10 seconds.
Okay, so calling people not, as Jonathan was saying, we should all be working together at the college of complexes to change America. We shouldn't be fighting among ourselves. So we shouldn't be dividing and conquering. We should be saying that every group has a right to fight for the 99%, and the 1%, no matter if they're Catholic, Jewish, Christian, Baptist, or whatever, they're the enemy, and we should all focus on that. Thank you.
All right, is there anybody else who wishes to give a rebuttal speech? Anybody? Oh, yes. I just wanted to say also, if you want to give a rebuttal speech, you can. This is kind of like the on-deck chair. So if you want to give a rebuttal speech, you can come and sit in this chair, and if you want to go up next.
I didn't sit in the chair, but I'm going to give
a rebuttal. No matter. I didn't. It's my bad. No, don't worry about it. It's my bad because I didn't tell. It's my fault because I didn't say that to anybody before. But go ahead.
First I want to thank Andy for taking the time to come up here. There's a lot of stuff in there that I really appreciated hearing. Stuff like the Schomburg energy efficiency, and I'm going to look that up. This changes everything, that book, Project Sensor, and the list of books and resources. I really do appreciate that. One thing that I like when I listen to people talk is I like to have them give me specific facts and then cite their sources. It gives me an opportunity to fact check them and make my own judgment, because there's a ton of facts out there. Sometimes it's kind of hard to figure out who's telling all the truth or some of the truth.
Oh, sorry. It's
okay. There were a couple of things that I was a little frustrated with. I saw a lot of books come out and I didn't see a lot of facts, but there were some facts and I did have some issues with them. The first one is when he mentioned that when you talked about media, I have similar concerns, but my understanding of the facts are different. My understanding is that the problem with media is really the concentration of media ownership. That there are, my understanding, and anyone's welcome to fact check me because I'm going off the top of my head, but 5%, or there are five corporations in the United States, five corporations that own 95% of the media in this country. And that includes television, movie companies, magazines, newspapers, and book publishers. For five corporations to control basically what Americans here, there's a lot of complaints about that. So that's my understanding of the problem. It's slightly different than what Andy says. I don't know about the Jewish factor and who runs the companies, but that's one fact that I think is very important. And I also think it relates to what I understood the topic of this discussion to be, and that is what the candidates are not discussing, which really didn't seem to cover tonight, but I think that that's a big problem in who's controlling the media and how the candidates adjust to what they're saying. So anyway, that's one thing that I think is important. Another fact, he talked about, started talking about 9/11, and there were a ton of books he presented, but there weren't, I didn't hear a lot of facts. One thing that he did, Andy did say, is that there was a woman who wrote about how the steel failed after 30 minutes of a fire when it was rated for 4 hours. I am not an expert on 9/11. I've done a little reading on it, but I did hear them talk about that. And what they said is that the architects were very proud about how they overbuilt the structure, and they built it so that it would survive a fire for a long time, that all that steel had fireproofing on it. They also talked about how the building was designed to be hit by a jetliner. They actually designed it so it would be hit by a jetliner.
They did, yeah.
That's in the reports. But what they didn't do is they didn't consider what would happen for both. And what happened is that these jetliners were carrying full amount of fuel, 80,000 pounds of kerosene. So what happened is this double whammy. They had a massive structural failure combined with a huge fire of 80,000 gallons of kerosene. I'm sorry, pounds, 80,000 pounds of kerosene. And it just wasn't, it couldn't handle that. So that's why, that's my understanding of what really was going on. And I do have concerns when I hear people talking about the conspiracy theories. I think the government's up to a lot of no good, but I just don't think they're that competent to hide up that huge of a cover-up.
Yeah, I got another.
So that's my take on 9/11. I have some other notes, but...
just a moment.
Okay, your time's up.
Hey, my time's up, so...
Okay, next speaker. Next speaker, we got an open mic.
All right.
We have a woman's point of view.
Let's go. Come on, we got to keep moving here. It's
Hello, hi. My name is Ellen. And didn't really prepare for this speech, and I just got here a short time ago. I just wanted to say about the 9/11. I completely disagree with the idea that you just need a seventh grade education to understand 9/11. That is completely not true. I mean, I have a relative who's a material physicist, and he used to be, he's a physicist. He used to be an engineer, a material engineer. And, you know, he was telling me about how, you know, you have to understand how the buildings are made. And I have heard things from speakers here about 9/11 that are inaccurate about how the buildings are made. It's just not true. And this idea that, oh, they're just coming down, crashing down, and you can just see it in like free fall. Well, that's is the way it does look, and that doesn't mean that it's free fall. You know, that just means that the supports have all collapsed. I mean, there's just a lot of inaccurate things that are being stated as if they're fact, and as if anybody with a seventh grade science education would know this, and that's just not true. That's just not true. Okay. But the main thing that I wanted to just mention is we have a presidential election coming up very shortly, and this is a very serious situation. Donald Trump wants to stifle the media. I mean, he basically wants to get rid of the First Amendment. He goes around threatening to sue journalists who haven't even done. And he doesn't even understand really the concepts of libel and slander. He goes around threatening to sue them when they haven't done anything wrong, legally wrong. And he wants to make things a lot tougher for them. He does have a lot of fascist tendencies. And obviously he's racist. He was behind the Truther movement. I mean, not the Truther movement. Sorry, he was behind the Barack Obama not being born in the U.S. All that BS. So I suppose that's probably part of a racist tendency. He's got this crazy idea that we shouldn't let any Muslims into the country. I mean, we need to be building a coalition with them. I mean, this is exactly the kind of stuff that ISIS and Bin Laden would want. I think he's really dangerous to our democracy, and I think that we should do everything we can to defeat him. And this idea, some people have this idea that, oh, well, it doesn't make that much of a difference because, presidents don't have that much power anyway. Kind of, our president doesn't really... There are forces that are going to stop him, and maybe they'll assassinate him or something or another. I mean, I've heard people speak this way. I mean, I think he can do enough damage, and he might do a lot of damage. So I think we should all work hard, maybe campaign in some of the
swing states.
Okay, that's all I want to say. Thank you.
Go Gary
Johnson.
Ahead.
Who do you think is more likely to get us into a war with Iran, Trump or Clinton?
Trump.
She's asking me, not you.
You don't have a question in the
Wait, Charlie, don't. Okay. Charlie, Ellen still has time.
We don't have rebuttal.
She has an opinion.
She asked me, not somebody else.
Yeah.
And
we don't have question and answer for rebuttal.
I don't know whether Hillary has been speaking negatively about Iran and in a threatening way, and I have no idea what Trump will do. He has no experience. We don't really know what he stands for. He doesn't seem to have any consistent, he just kind of goes with the flow. He doesn't seem to have any consistent policies or thoughts besides from building the wall, which he's kind of trying to go back on. So I just think he's too much of a loose cannon, and we don't know what to expect from him.
Okay.
P.T. Barnum.
All right.
Ahead,
okay. All right. No Q&A during rebuttals.
Charlie.
Yeah, what are you, y'all, Mr. Rules? All of a sudden, they go up to the sky.
Take it outside. Discuss it with me. We can discuss it outside the restaurant.
Since when do we have a question and answer during the thing?
All right, Charlie, 4 minutes.
Charlie. Let's thank our speaker. And first I agree with the third one is. Let's see, your assertion is that there's corporate media censorship. And I would not approve that story because there's no truth or evidence of it existing. The corporate media guides that I use for the United States would be like 5 or 6 volumes of the old Chicago telephone book. Who's controlling all of those individuals at radio stations that are broadcasting 24 hours a day, all the articles written in all the newspapers and magazines in the United States, newsletters and on the internet, as well as all the 24 hours of all the television stations broadcasting news. Now, in order to affect censorship, I would censor your story because you have to prove that someone is conveying what stories are okay and not okay. And on the other side, you have to indicate you have to discipline or affect controls over what is in fact published. Now, you can tell me, I would like to know the location of the central registry that reviews all the media that's generated in the course of a single day in the United States, and who's reviewing it. Now, somehow you say, it's a control. What happens if you violate the rules? And you say something, well, it's refuted in the New York Times. And I don't know exactly what that means. Now, if there is, in fact, an operating entity of censorship, and I've heard this many times, how, in fact, does it operate? And I'm given no details whatsoever, indication, ever. You said, well, there's, and I even refute the fact that the media, I don't ever look into this, but to say that five individuals control all those media outlets is spurious and not substantiated by anything that I've seen in dealing with the media and over the years that I have. Now, the next one is, refuting the next one. You say there's censorship of this. And you say, well, there's an extensive database. You quote Jim Mars. Jim Mars is a guy who also happens to believe that there's alien bases on the dark side of the moon. Now, this is the gentleman that's running misinformation on 9/11. You know, the other thing is that you also use as your database source Judy Woods, who maintains that there was a directed energy weapon someplace in New York City, in Manhattan Island, that was aimed at the Twin Towers. And I guess it wasn't precisely tuned so that it was toasting, she says toasting cars, burning up cars, because I guess they didn't aim it too well. Or maybe it just wasn't, they didn't know how to operate it or something like this. But anyhow, the directed energy weapon was getting targets around Manhattan, quite a few apparently, that it didn't. And I guess it hit other buildings as well, which might explain Building 7. If you're doing cars all over Manhattan, as she claims, it's not surprising that you wouldn't hit another building or two, since this beam is like, doing the southern, the lower part of Manhattan. Now, okay, I would have to censor that story too. Now, am I justified in this regard? You could say whether I am or not, but I think I am. To say that there's an operating, the overall thing is that you have a responsibility when you've got a thing that goes out and you're the editor or the publisher. Or, I was in book publishing. When we're in the house, the name of the house. You don't publish anything, especially some of the old established ones, that isn't 100% absolutely totally accurate. You don't even publish disclaimers. There was one publisher who put a book out and put a little disclaimers that we don't, and they were criticized severely for doing this. So they said if it was Random House, if you don't stand by the books that you're publishing, then you shouldn't be publishing. That's the standards that they adhere to. Anyhow, good thing. Thanks. Good to hear from you again, Andy. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah. Who's going to start a war?
All right.
Hillary Clinton.
All right. Does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? No? All right. Well. Well. First of all, I'll give a rebuttal speech, and I'm going to reset the timer on this sucker, so that. I can't. Okay, this thing just froze on me. I'm just going to time it. I'm going to time it myself using my own watch. I'm going to put the watch down here. And, okay, so I'm going to time it from now. That thing, Tim's computer froze on him. All right. First of all, let's have a round of applause for Andy for coming and giving this presentation tonight. All right, I just wanted to say that I think, Andy, I think you did a really good job tonight with your presentation. It was very well organized, and it was you ran on schedule. I thought you really did good. And I wish every presentation at the College of Complexes could run on time.
I concur.
As well as Andy did. I've been accused of being a conscious agent of the establishment and of trying to silence Andy, who is because he's trying to tell the truth. Now, the truth of the matter is actually that I agree with about three quarters of what Andy says, and for the most part, Andy and I are on the same page in terms of our political views. So we don't really disagree on our opinions. Where Andy and I disagree is on some of the facts. And I think a lot of you already know my views on 9/11. Let me just tell you, Charlie, I would like to point out where I do agree with Andy, and on the subject of press censorship. Now, Charlie, you said there's no censorship of the press. If you think that there is no government pressure on the press, you should talk to Dan Rather about that. Because if there wasn't, Dan Rather might still be the anchor of CBS News. And also, Bill Moyers might still be working for PBS, and Bob Edwards might still be the host of Morning Edition on NPR. But these people, when George W. Bush was president, there was a purge of the mainstream media, and the people that were critical of the Bush administration were basically forced out. Now I will agree with Charlie that our censorship is not as severe as that of North Korea, where of course the government runs the media themselves. Nevertheless, and I'm not alone in this. I just was reading the Freedom House website. There is an attempt by the government to control the media, and this didn't end when Barack Obama replaced George W. Bush. It has continued in the Obama administration. Journalists who publish things analogous to Neil Sheehan publishing the Pentagon Papers are now threatened with jail time. You should talk, if you think that there's no censorship, you should talk to Glenn Greenwald, you should talk to Chelsea Manning, you should talk to Edward Snowden. You should talk to Julian Assange.
How many people are in jail?
Hey, Charlie, no, one fool at a time. Now, as a matter of fact, I'm glad you mentioned that, because Chelsea Manning is in jail. Julian Assange is in a kind of prison. He's trapped in the Ecuadorian embassy and cannot leave. Glenn Greenwald is in exile in a country that does not have an extradition treaty with the United States. So the United States, and so we don't want to admit it, the United States has become a less free country than it was 15 years ago. And unfortunately, a lot of it is due to 9/11. So we're at a crossroads now. Are we going to continue down this road? Or are we going to, try and bring back the kind of freedom of the press and freedom of speech that we once had? But the choice is up to you.
All right. Andy, final comments. Andy, final comments.
I would like to thank everyone that gave a rebuttal. Because it's, if you look at it, each person, gave a demonstration of what I've been talking about, where people are very, very knowledgeable about something they've been studying, but not so knowledgeable about something that they haven't been studying, and they're still working with so-called facts from the media that aren't correct. I'll just, real briefly, One thing I would say about Tim's rebuttal about the new Thorium Alliance is, on sheer cost, the cost and the time it would take to build a thorium nuclear power plant, the ratio, we had a figure 10 by 10 by 10. If you want as much energy as a thorium nuclear plant could put out, you can get that many kilowatts for one-tenth the cost of the plant in one-tenth the time it would take to build it from solar and wind power. Solar and wind and renewable, when you add up the total cost of nuclear fuel and everything it takes to run the plant, on cost alone, building nuclear plants would take away money needed for actually going super efficient and solving the global climate CO2 problem. Daniel Weinberg mentioned it's all about oil. There are wars. It's not. We don't need the oil in the Middle East. America is an exporter of oil right now. They import and export. But the global the problem with the Middle East, it's a global domination problem, as Professor Griffin pointed out in several of his books. It's all about controlling the oil in the Middle East, so we can control the economies of other countries and threaten them with withdrawal if they don't pay our prices, our billionaires. The multi-trillion dollar fossil fuel industry is like the 800 pound gorilla with or big octopus with its tentacles wrapped around the planet. It's not going to go quietly, and that's why each of us that understands has the obligation. We have, there's 300 million of us in America or something. Each of us has 1/300 millionth of the responsibility to move forward and help people learn. Jonathan was absolutely right when he said, we can't allow incidents like what we had where one person or another is attacked for something, and it's always divide and conquer when you're trying to have a lucid, critical, collegial discussion on solving problems, then somebody wants to attack somebody else, and it slows down the process of learning. We have to be able to fact check. Who was it that said we have to be able to fact check? A lot of books and not enough facts. Well, if I listed a ton of facts out of each one of these books, we'd be here for 8 hours. I listed major facts. Number one, you know, there's massive number of huge amount of evidence on each one of the four things we listed tonight. I would suggest, no, let me, I don't want to get off track here because you only got a couple minutes. The person that listed 80,000 pounds of jet fuel, they didn't plan for that. Well, that's not correct. They didn't study for it. They didn't plan for an airliner loaded with fuel because they knew the fuel, what the temperature the fuel burned at would make no difference on the steel structure. No steel structure in the world has ever been brought down by an office fire or burning jet fuel. Not any steel structures with the type of girders that were in the towers in Building 7. Those are the only three buildings that we were told were brought down by fire. Incidentally, if you read and study this, in the World Trade Center specifically, in Building 1 and 2, there was a, sir, I was trying to answer your question. What's his name? What is your name, sir?
Yeah.
David? I was trying to answer your question specifically, that this was directed at you personally about listing a fact. You listed a fact that's been promoted by the media that's been proven to be totally false. Whatever the airliner crash events were at the two Twin Towers, they had no effect on the collapse of those buildings at all. The firefighters, there's radio transmissions. The firefighters, the survivors, you look into their surviving, what they call a historical record, the tapes. And the firefighters were reporting on that day. They were up there on the 78th floor putting out the fire when the explosives were triggered. The surviving firefighters, when they got back, there's 118 firefighters' histories that said we watched the layers of explosives going off as they came from the top down. The two twin towers were converted to dust in 9 seconds before anything hit the ground. They were dustified. That's what these two books were describing. There's no debate in the scientific community that the towers were converted to dust. The debate is over what kind of machinery was used. It wasn't a beam weapon from space, like Charlie says, to denigrate that woman that wrote the physics textbook. They're talking about something new, some kind of military energy that produced the results of converting hundreds of thousands of tons of concrete to fine powdery dust. They were dustified. That's what the physicists said. So one theory, they think it was small mini nukes that our country's had for years, the Davy Crockett shells. They have a 200-foot blast radius and can direct a beam of intense energy up that will dissolve concrete and steel. So that's where the debate is in the scientific community over some kind of other directed energy weapon that we don't know about that the military has, or the mini nukes. Anyway, they don't want to admit that they have something that can dustify buildings in seconds. Alan said you don't need, that seventh graders wouldn't understand this. I beg to differ. As I said earlier, the hard part is stepping through the psychological barrier and looking at the evidence. If you can't step through the barrier, if you stay on this side believing the official fairy tale, then you can't look at the evidence that all seven buildings of the Trade Center were demolished that day by explosives. They filmed the first two and sold it to us as a terrorist event. All we ever heard about was the Twin Towers, Twin Towers, Twin Towers. And a lot of New Yorkers for years didn't know about the third tower, Building 7, that came down in a controlled demolition at 5:20 in the afternoon. So. And Charlie says, Charlie never sees any evidence of censorship because he never reads the books that describe how media censorship functions in the United States and how journalists are taught how not to get fired and blackballed if you're going to be a journalist in any major media center in this country. You try to go after stories that are taboo or radioactive and you get fired in a heartbeat. And that book, I would suggest Charlie read that book, Into the Buzzsaw, from 2004. You can get it at the library. It tells 18 stories of Pulitzer Prize winners that were fired and blackballed because they were trying to report a story that was censored. It goes on all the time in America, but mostly there's no central censoring authority. It's the individual owners, the six owners that control the bulk of the media, they basically set the agenda.
Oh.
Okay.
Being owners. I have one last thing.
By being owners?
Yeah, they own the media.
How do they convey?
It's easy.
Hey, one pool at a time, Charlie.
Don said he agrees with about three quarters
let's wrap it up.
I had to say, but we disagree on facts. Well, I would suggest to Don to study some of the books that actually have the documented facts in them. It's like, you know, people presented this fact that we could build nuclear power plants in a couple of years. They make it sound super simple. Well, it's not. The reality is something different. And the same thing with a lot of other facts that we didn't even get a chance to talk about. On that yellow flyer on the back of the one that has the top 10, there's that golden triangle with the three most radioactive subjects in America. You try to talk about any one of those, and it's instant career suicide.
Okay.
So that's it, and we will see you again someday.
Have a sound time.
All right, that's college is adjourned.
Dave, the time that we do have